Going to. So, Erev Tov, good evening, everybody. It's a fantastic time for all of us to get muted. No, I'm saying this is in a nice way. We are so excited that after the letter Yud comes the letter Kaf. That's what we are honoring tonight, number 20. So to speak. And before we go even farther, we're going to get to, I'm gonna share the screen to get all the way to the Pizmon that we always sing together. So it's called Adona Selichot. And we are celebrating now the second of the lines of the piyut. And that is Kovesh Avonot. Avonot, how can I say it? Mistakes, we call it. Kovesh is to conquer them. Well, we have to discuss at some point what does it mean? If it's connected to Pirkei Avot, Kovesh et Yitzro. To actually to conquer one's inner being. So anyway, if you remember, we sing together this refrain. And I come from a little before, two lines before. Tovu metiv laberiot, yode akol nistarot, kovesh avonot, lobesh tzedakot, chatan ulefanecha, rachem alenu. So that's the Pizmon, that's the refrain that we always use to remind ourselves of the importance of this slicha, of this prayers to plead. And now we are in family because Liora Moriel, our guest and presenter this evening, was born in Israel, raised in Canada, received a doctoral degree in comparative literature at the University of Maryland, and now lives with her wife and twin teens in the USA, here in Silver Spring. She produced the first international festival of women in music in Be'er Sheva, Israel. Wow. And she has traveled the world with her guitar and has recorded an EP and an LP. And without any further ado, I'm so honored and so happy that Liora Moriel said Ken. And Ken also has the letter Kaf in it. She said yes. And because of that, we are now being able to listen to her wonderful, wonderful teachings. Toda rabah, Liora, please unmute yourself so we can listen to you, and I'll make sure that everybody can see you. Kol hakavod.
Kulam ayu yodim al kol. Okay, Erev Tov, good evening. Today we will examine the letter Kaf, which is the 11th letter in the Hebrew alphabet. This means that we're halfway through our Slichot journey, because there are only 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet. Halfway to examining the past year, our deeds, our misdeeds. Have we identified our sins, missteps, mistakes? Have we identified the people from whom we would ask forgiveness? Have we identified the people we would forgive? Because while God can absolve us of a lot, the goddess cannot absolve us of sins against others. But we have time. We are only halfway there. We have time. possibly we have a long, long time because our letter is Kaf. And Kaf embraces everything, the whole wide world, all of space and all of time. And if Chazan Ramon can show us the first slide, that'll be great.
Yes.
Give the one that everybody
I'm coming, I'm coming, Mamash.
Thank you.
Yes, of course.
This is the slide we've come to expect during these Selihot. The one that shows the letter as it was in ancient Hebrew and modern Hebrew. Here we go from left to right. You'll see the ancient one that looks like a hand all the way back. So now we can look at it, and now we can take it off and continue. As we can see, the most ancient depiction of the letter looks like a cuff, a hand. It also, if you realize it, it looks like an inverted chamsa, right? So hand, chamsa, which does not begin with a chaf, but a chet. So the hand that keeps things at bay, right? The chamsa. No, we don't need this.
I'll call you when. Selicha.
We don't need this. Yeah. No, that's okay. So this is a little trivia quiz. What do we call a group of bananas? Anybody know?
A hand.
A hand, yeah. A hand of bananas. One of those little things. Anyway, now you know. Back to our Hebrew letter Kaf. It changed its shape over time, as you noticed, but not its meaning. The modern shape of Kaf is a curved spoon, for Kaf means spoon in Hebrew. And it's a letter that is bent, kafuf, kfufa, again, beginning with a chaf. It represents the aspect of submitting oneself to a higher, greater power. As many rabbis pointed out, Kaf is like a cupped, outstretched palm, like this, right? A vessel, ready to receive. The shape of all containers, jars, saucers, bowls, cups, is based on that basic curved shape. In other words, it's not enough to think about doing good. We must find a way of bringing it to reality. And Kaf teaches us to shape ourselves, to bend the ego, and reshape our character. Not an easy task, right? So Kaf also teaches us to bend matter to the spirit and the spirit to the matter, constantly connecting the thought of wisdom with its action. Should I do this? Oh, well, some people do without thinking, so we always need to think about why action is done. Because it's not enough to think about doing good. We must find a way to act upon it and bring it about in reality, in principle. And by the way, the word for principle is klal, also beginning with a kaf. And we'll get back to that in a little bit. And by the way, kaf, if I'm going to piggyback on what Moria said yesterday about the yud becoming vav, becoming nuns of feet, you know, yud, vav, nuns of feet, now you can see it. Kaf is very interesting because kaf and chaf, the final one, make a word, kach, which is thus. This is the way things are. So, tachlis. How do we negotiate moving between our imperfect world and the perfect world to come? As we know, the sinner is well positioned to teach others how to behave, right? This is the way of the world. Those who can do good deeds. Those who can't teach others how to do good deeds instead of them. So how often do we see a person who's truly humble live their life, while those who lack humility insist on teaching them how to be humble? Anyway, there's one wonderful, truly humble teacher. who, because of his devout and honest teachings and life, has been revered for centuries, and that's Rabbi Nachman Mbreslev. And now we can do the second slide. Every Rosh Hashanah, Rabbi Nachman's disciples arrive in his village, Uman, in Ukraine, to celebrate his teachings. This is the most famous. Da sheha'olam gesher tzar me'od veha'ikar. Well, actually, that's not. This is what the song is. What Nachman said is da sheha'olam gesher tzar me'od me'od veha'klal veha'ikar. Lo lefached klal. No, that the world is a very, very narrow bridge, and the klal is not to be afraid klal. Clearly, klal has two meanings here. We have klal in the sense of principle, and klal as everyone, at all. So, 200 years later, Rabbi Baruch Hait, an Orthodox Jewish rabbi in Israel, he wrote this song based on Rab Nachman Mbreslev, and it does a little bit of an injustice to the meaning, because the song translates here as the whole world is a very narrow bridge and the main thing is not to be afraid. Whereas before we had Kol Ha'olam Kulo Gesher Tzar Me'od Me'od, a very, very, very narrow bridge. The haklal, the haikal, lo lefached. And so, not, don't fear at all, but the tenet is not to be afraid. God will guide us. So, if we take it, we can all sing together this piyut, as very, very famous now all over the world. Kol ha'olam kulo gesher tzar me'od, gesher tzar me'od, gesher tzar me'od. Kol ha'olam kulo gesher tzar me'od, gesher tzar me'od. Ve'ha'ikar, ve'ha'ikar, lo lefached, lo lefached klal. Ve'ha'ikar, ve'ha'ikar, lo lefached klal. Kol ha'olam kulo gesher tzar me'od, gesher tzar me'od, gesher tzar me'od. So, we don't need the slide anymore, thank you. So, we're halfway through the alphabet, our journey to forgiveness. We've traveled from Aleph to Kaf, from the divine beginning to the divine end. He's got the whole world in his hands. She's got the whole wide world in her hands. She's got the whole world in our hands. We've got the whole world in our hand. And that whole world, that hand, includes everyone. Jews, other believers, non-believers, able-bodied people, not able-bodied people, disabled. We now have the Tokyo Paralympics to see how well they can do, how accomplished they can be. Articulate people and those who cannot speak. People who cannot follow, people who cannot lead, people who love, people who hate, those we love not so much, not at all. And the beasts, the plants, the elements, the entire creation, kol ha'olam kulo. What we can see, what we may surmise, what we can't even imagine. Everyone, kol ha'olam, everything. So now let's look at slide number 3, which is the letter kaf, just to remind us again what kaf looks like. Chazan Ramon, could you put that slide of kaf up again, please? Here we go. So you see how curved it is? This is the modern kaf. We sang about the whole world, the whole wide world, and it reminded me, I know I digress, of Shakespeare. Didn't Shakespeare note in As You Like It that all the world's a stage? A stage in which all men and all women are merely players? If you look closely, you'll see that the letter kaf actually looks like a stage without the fourth wall. Okay, let's remove that. And I'd like you to think about how you'd like to stage your life, our life. How can we fit all those we love and admire on that stage? How can we write the words that will express the sentiment of our most sincere apologies to those we have wronged in a big or a small way this year? We need to take ourselves in hand. We need to move to the next word that begins with kaf now, and that is the word kavod. Kavod for this session will be translated as honor as well as respect. We honor, we pay our respects to those we admire, and certainly to the one God. We honor and respect the teachings of the one God and our parents and elders. Sometimes kavod can be less than a stellar attribute, such as when someone asks us to bow to their wishes, or when we lord it over them and demand that they honor and respect us no matter what we do. This can be bein adam lechaveru, between friends, or within the family, or between a despot and their subjects, or a false prophet and their acolytes, and we've seen a lot of that. But when we say kavod in liturgical context, we mean respect and honor to the one God. Kavod, kavod, honor and respect. We honor and respect those that we admire. We expect honor and respect for our accomplishments, and sometimes we wish to be forgiven because we are rich and famous, honored and respected by the masses. Except that's not the way forgiveness works, right? Kavod is a masculine word in gendered Hebrew. It appears 199 times in the Tanakh. We give kavod to the one God, and we ask for kavod from those around us. Kavod is a positive reinforcement. But now we're living through a totally different era, aren't we, as of a year and a half ago. So as Avinon ben Mordechai observed last year, quote, the coronavirus pandemic denotes, you know, who the World Health Organization said that it's COVID-19, coronavirus disease 2019, COVID-19. It's indicative of and sounds like kavod. That's food for thought. We need to have respect in a healthy dose of it for this little virus, this disease, because it looks like it's going to be with us a long time, and we need to have kavod for all the things that God created, tiny as they may be. Then, as we add the feminine ah to the Hebrew word kavod, we get kvudam, which is what we carry with us on the plane. Kvudam is our luggage. But kvudam may be a terrible burden, like our sins. In order to honor the people in our lives and respect them fully for who they are, wonder and warts and everything in between, we need to take the time to examine how we treat them. Are we too lenient? Are we too harsh? Too busy? Too picky? Too distracted? Too blind? We too fail from time to time as parents, teachers, friends, children, colleagues. We take on too little or too much. We do our best or just enough to get by. We need to examine how we treat ourselves as well as how we treat others. Do we cut ourselves some slack? Do we give ourselves a moment to breathe? Do we relax? Do we rush through life without really seeing or feeling anything or anyone? We need to unburden, let go of the kvuda, so we can move forward with greater speed and purpose towards the goal of selichot, which is the forgiveness of our misdeeds, mistakes, misrepresentations, whether to others or to us, and God sees everything. We cannot hide, nor should we, because we are halfway on the road to selichot, and if our heart is in it, if we do it with kavod, with kavana, which is another word with chav, then we will definitely make it. So to conclude, I would like to share with you something that Chazan Mamon has shown me before, but I'd like to show it in this context. The song Al Kol Ele by Naomi Shemer, that I think all of you know. Kol means everything, klal, everyone, and the kulelenu is a group of three people who go around the world and get thousands of people together, perfect strangers, to sing together a song that they've put together in a magnificent way. And we will now hear Naomi Shemer's Al Kol Ele. Shlomi Shabbat is the main singer, and 10,000 people in Jerusalem sing with him, including the former president, Rudy Rivlin. Let's go.
Thank you. הגן על החומה מידון מפחת אותה ומלחמה
to unmute.
Thank you for being such a great audience. Thank you for letting me share my thoughts, and I'd be happy to hear yours.
And Liora, we have to say, Kevodenu, is our honor to have you teach us. It's our honor to hear from you and observe the beautiful thoughts and ideas that you have brought tonight. As we continue in this cheshbon ha-nefesh, I always use that word, Rowan is an accountant, so I have to do good. Cheshbon ha-nefesh, the accounting of our soul. And as we continue, as you expressed so well, in the middle of the road, as we are going all the way to Rosh Hashanah, we want to really, really thank you, Toda Rabah, for this beautiful, beautiful presentation, lifting our souls, our hearts, that sometimes are kvedim, that they are so heavy, and you lift them up. And I want to tell you, I just want to see in here, you says, David Balto is telling us that as long as we are thinking about honey, remember you can buy honey and apples and flowers and prayer books at Shirat HaNefesh, get together this Sunday at 1 p.m. Exactly. And we want to all tell you as well that we continue tomorrow night with another dear, dear friend that just came back from Israel, Evelyn Zuckerman, and that she's going to be teaching our letter Lamed. And we continue on all the way to Thursday night. And after that, it comes Shabbat, Parashat Ki Tavo. I hope that you'll all come and join me for services, as we're going to be discussing the very important element of memory. And finally, on Saturday night, we get into the Selihot Ashkenazi version. And we are going to do it following the topic, the text, the idea that we are embracing at Shirat HaNefesh this year, Shav'at Aniyim Ata Tishma, the clamor of the poor. You will hear, we hope, that not only we will be able to see that God help us to achieve social economic equality and the end of racism for once and for all. And so we're going to have with us, will there be an email for Saturday night? If you go to the publicity of Selihot, there is the same registration. You should do that. And I want to say also that we're going to have Jews United for Justice and Bend the Arc, two wonderful organizations that are going to come and talk to us about how can to become more active. As Liora told us, and she told us, not only the important aspect of dreaming the dream, but also to coming down to earth and doing the hard work. So we're going to do all that. And in the meantime, I wish you all Laila Tov. May you have a wonderful
Laila Tov.
And thank you all of you for all this support. More than 250 people that have registered, more than 30 people every night coming to do what Herzl told us, Im Tirtzu Ein Zo Agada. And if you want it, this is not only a dream, it's a reality, and it's a reality because you're here every single night. So thank you, Liora, and everyone that presents, and thank you.
Thank you for inviting me.
Of course.
Laila Tov.
Until then, Laila Tov, thank you, all of you. Bye-bye.
Laila Tov.